Welcome back to a lecture series on igneous and metamorphic petrology. So, since last few six classes, what we have seen is the general igneous rocks, how igneous rocks are formed from magma, what are the different types of magma based on the composition of magmatic type, and what types of magma you will get, and what is the end product of rock, and the igneous rocks are normally classified based on mineralogy, based on hand specimen, based on chemical composition. So we have seen in the same line that Tyrrell, Stabler and IUGS classification and so on. And today's class, what we are going to discuss about the types of variation diagram involved in classifying the rocks. We have used different diagrams to represent what the rock it is, how it is classified, how it is named. Normally, you have a diagram, you need to have two variant to take up your diagram, that is called bivariate. Sometimes you can take up three variant oxides to represent your diagram. And these diagrams are being used mainly based on the composition. Normally, if a component composed of more than 1% of any material in a rock is counted as counted for plotting the diagram, that is called major element. We are using major element, we are using minor in case if the percentage of the contribution for the formation of rock is very less, that is called minor. And in some cases it will be very less, and that is called rare earth and trace elements and so on. Many things of the periodic table is taken up to for the plotting the mineral composition for the concentration of rock and to classify the name. So, in this context, types of variation diagram plays a major, very important role. And when you want to understand the variation diagram, first we have to generally study about the elements on the earth crust. As I said, if either it is equal to 1 or sometimes more than 1% of any concentration, that is the first point, if any concentration should be taken as a major element. So, major element that have concentration greater than 1 or equal to 1. Of 8%, it controls the mineralogy. You have to take that, that's going to control the mineralogy of the particular rock, and in turn by using that we are going to coin the name of the rock type. It controls the mineralogy, crystallization, melting of the system to decide to and dictate viscosity, density and diffusivity of the rock. These are the elements used to classify the igneous rocks. Normally what we do, we use either XRF method for AA or AAS method, or sometimes combined method to assess for chemical routine geochemical analysis of a rock should do by a geologist from the geological material can be carried out using either a single method or a combination of these two. XRF, it's being used to determine the major and trace element. AAS is helpful to determine both major and trace element. Sometimes you can use these two for classifying a rock. The three groups of elements are analyzed in igneous rocks. As I said, major contribution, minor contribution or trace contribution, or very very less, rare earth elements or lanthanides. Atomic number between 57 to 71 is grouped as REE. That is also to be taken into account for assessing the rock type. Major elements, as we have listed over here, of course I don't want to read. This is the major concentration, of course I don't want to read the other things. Silicon dioxide, aluminum dioxide, titanium oxide, ferric, ferrous, manganese, magnesium, calcium, sodium, potassium and all this P2O5. And all these elements are categorized as major. Its contribution is more for forming the rock type. And similarly, minor, it is very less, like lithium and other, you have plenty, N number is there, of course, I don't want to read. And lithium, beryllium, strontium, vanadium, chromium, cobalt, nickel and so on, zinc. And similarly, for rare earth element, you or lanthanides groups between 57 to 71 are reported in ppm, parts per million or milligram per gram. The rare earth elements are important for petrogenetic, if you want to assess the origin of the rock type, rare earth element study is highly required. And major element variations, and normally this major element variations will be represented. You know that major elements will make up 99%. If it is more than 1%, that should be taken into major element of most igneous rock composition. The variation diagrams are generally used to describe and interpret the patterns found in suits. What is the pattern? What element dominates? The presence of that element, is it shows increasing trend or decreasing trend? So bivariate diagram is the best diagram. These are used to plot two parameters by taking two parameters. These are plotted on an XY graph. We will see in the next slide. And the next other diagram is called triangular diagram. The name represents by taking three parameters. It's used to relative proportions of three variables. Maybe variables may be magnesium, iron, and manganese oxide. This can also be combined elements that act similar characteristics. The diagram chosen are often varied to try to determine the best way to analyze the data. And this is the best examples of bivariant diagram. In the horizontal axis, you see white percentage of silicon dioxide is taken, and in the y axis, you see you have other oxides are taken: aluminium and dioxide, iron oxide, ferrous and magnesium, calcium, sodium oxide, potassium oxide. So this is the concentration of potassium. This is the concentration of sodium. This is the concentration of calcium, magnesium, and this is the concentration of ferrous oxide and aluminium dioxide. And you see, it's a very excellent diagram by taking white percentage of silicon dioxide and potassium. And you see the variations of white percentage of quartz 45 here, 55% of quartz is here, 65% of silicon dioxide and 75% of silicon dioxide. If silicon dioxide increases, the percentage of potassium will also increase. If the silicon dioxide decreases, the percentage of potassium also decreases. And in this case, it increases at certain level up to 60. Again, there is a fall of trending back again. So quartz increases, sodium increases up to 65%. After 65% of sodium, the sodium percentage tend to decrease. Quartz dominate in that particular magmatic rock or igneous rocks. And in this case, you see the higher concentration of quartz decreases the percentage of occupancy of calcium. What does it mean? Calcium will take only very less calcium of higher quartz replaces calcium. If the quartz is reduced, there you will get a calcium concentration is more. And similarly, magnesium, wherever it is reached, their percentage of quartz will be low. And wherever the magnesium decreases slowly, wherein you find the enrichment of quartz will be there. And this is the trend to assess. This type of bivariant diagram will be helpful. This is the oldest method. It was given by Harker. This is called Harker diagram. Bivariate methods of analysis is called as Harker diagram. It was introduced in 1909. And they have taken silicon dioxide in horizontal axis and all other oxides in the vertical axis to study about the pattern, the movement. The diagram represent the concentration movement from one end to another end by using XY variation diagram. Then the another diagram, you don't need to use only silicon dioxide. You can also take in horizontal axis magnesium oxide and on the vertical axis calcium. And here you see 0 to 8%. If the magnesium increases, calcium percentage of calcium oxide is also increases. If the magnesium oxide decreases, CaO also decreases. At which this is the end point at which you see a box represent a primitive melting. A dark square is the hypothetical primitive melt for the formation of basalt suit. So MgO is plotted in the horizontal axis instead of SiO2. The diagram is suitable for mafic rock, that is especially basalt, because magnesium oxide decreases considerably as this basalt differentiate. Magnesium oxide considerably decreases, basalt differentiate. On the other hand, silicon dioxide shows little change. Of course, when you see the last diagram, it shows only little changes in the variation of the magma. But this diagram tells you that lot of changes at which you are reaching your primitive. The different basalts making this oxide unsuitable for monitoring differentiation, but this is good. Dark square is the hypothetical, this square is the hypothetical primitive melt for basalt suit. Like the Harker diagram, in the earlier diagram, the MgO can be plotted against any other oxide also. Coming to the next diagram is total alkali and silica. So total alkali, silica is taken at x-axis, and in y-axis weight percentage of sodium potassium is taken. And here it, this percentage of what is that silica, you have percentage of silica is represented, this is the percentage represent 45% to 53% basic, 52 to 63 is intermediate, and above the 63 is acidic, and less than 45 is ultra basic. And by taking this, you have your rock type, you can make, you know, this is the plot. After getting your analytical report, you plot and then see what type of magma oasis for which your rock is present. Useful for the classification of especially volcanic rocks. This is the total alkali versus silicon dioxide diagram. Also useful for distinguishing between two different parallel magma. Suppose if you have two parallel magma, you can use this to differentiate what magma is the source rock for your magma. Alkali magma are produced by partial melting at considerable depth and differentiate into a specific group. Tholitic magma form at shallower depth and may differentiate SiO2 over saturated rhyolite. So this is the triangular variation diagram. By taking three parameters like A represent for sodium and potassium, F represent iron component, and M represent MgO. 3-point system, trilinear diagram, of which you can see, suppose if you plot, your plot comes here, it is a rhyolite magma, dacite, andesite, basalt, this is calc-alkaline group, this is theodolite group. So triangular diagram, and this diagram usually present the variation of three chemical parameters. The most commonly used diagram is AFM diagram. This is AFM diagram used for representing mafic rocks, element taken. These values are either plotted as molecular weight, molecular or weight percent values. Figure AFM triangular diagram showing the demarcation between the theolytic and calc-alkaline divisions. So with this, the types of variation diagram and its representation for igneous rocks has come to an end. Thank you very much.